So far, I have tried to persuade you that government provided compensation increases with market value of property. Court provided compensation also increases with market value of property. And court provided compensation gets closer and closer to market value as market value itself increases. So now what I have not proved, given you evidence, suppose you ignore this black line. Suppose you ignore this line, the two statements will still be true, that government provided compensation increases with market value, courts give more than what government does, and courts give better deal to high value property owners. But the way I have depicted this in this diagram, I have indirectly claimed that both government as well as courts, even though are kinder than government when it comes to compensation, but courts also undercompensate property owners. Even though in my data set courts provided 4 times compensation than government did, but even after 4 times, the way this diagram shows, even after 4 times, increasing compensation 4 times, the compensation still remains below market value of property. I need to complete this last bit in my argument. And to do that, I do not have data, but I have logic that should be persuasive enough. So let me take you through that logic. So, and it pertains to how the compensation is determined by government official, and how judges determine compensation. The government compensation is provided by land acquisition collector, which is additional district commissioner, deputy commissioner. Now, what they do is, every district magistrate's deputy commissioner's office has rates that are called registry rates, that are also called stamp duty rates. In urban areas, in big cities like Kanpur, they might also be called circle rates. What are stamp duty rates? What are registry rates? Or in Panipat, they will be called collectory rates. Collectory rates, registry rates, stamp duty rates, circle rates. They are more or less, you know, same. It represents a tax. It is a form of tax that is imposed on any transaction. When you and me sign a sale deed, suppose you sell your property to me, I have given you money, I want to transfer ownership from your name into my name. For that, we will go to registrar's office. And that time, we have to pay a tax on transaction. It is a transaction tax. The rate for that tax is called stamp duty rate, or collectory rate, or circle rate. Now notice, this is, so let me ask you a hypothetical question. Suppose tax rate is 8% and it is on the value of transaction. Suppose we tell the registrar that we have made this deal in 100 rupees. What is the tax we will have to pay? 8 rupees. The law, Indian Stamp Duty Act, is silent on who pays. But between you and me, we will have to pay 8 rupees. Suppose we tell registrar that we have transacted this, we have carried out this transaction in 50 rupees. How much tax we will end up paying at same rate? 4. Remember, same property. If we let's rephrase the example. Suppose I bought this property in 1 crore. We speak truthfully. We truthfully report to registrar and tell that I bought this property in 1 crore. At 8%, registrar will demand that you buy stamp pay 8 lakhs. If we lie and say that 50 lakhs, value of this deal is 50 lakhs, we will pay only 4 lakhs. the land remains same, I have still given him 1 lakh, but tax paid will be half of that. 4 lakhs can be shared between two of us, you see. So, either I can pay him 2 lakh less or more. So, we can, you can see that any tax that is based on value, and value has to be reported by people who are involved, they have incentive to lie about that. Does it make sense? So, what are stamp duty rates? Collect, and ideally, we would like to say that he is my relative, I have gifted him this property free of cost, because that way we can save the entire 8 lakhs. We would want to do that, but we don't have option to do that. Registrar will say, I don't care, even if you have charged zero price from him, you need to pay minimum. You know, in my opinion, in that area, a property will be assessed worth at least 20 lakhs or 40 lakhs. So, it is the minimum valuation, that minimum tax that we have to pay. We cannot go below that. Is that, suppose, you know, suppose in the area that this property, it belong, whichever area it belongs to, suppose collectory rate or as per stamp duty rate, worth of this property is 40 lakhs. Though I bought it in 1 crore, we will have incentive to claim only 40 lakhs and not more than that. In some cases, if I am a corporation, I am not individual, then scope to lie is less, because I have to make all payment through check. Or I have borrowed money for housing, for my house from a bank. Again, if I argue that I have paid him, this land is worth 40 lakhs, I bought in 40 lakhs, I will get loan maximum to the tune of 40 lakhs. So, in some situation, people are forced to claim more than 40 lakhs, but they generally do not go all the way and speak truthfully and report 1 crore. So, in reality, in many situations, the rates in sale deeds will always be less than true transaction rate. Only rarely such a deal will be reported as a 1 crore deal. It will generally be reported a deal between 1 crore and 40 lakhs. So, that's story of all sale deeds in entire country. That means that this market, this property had market price of 1 crore, but sale deed of this property will report market price less than 1 crore. Suppose 70 lakhs, 80 lakhs, 60 lakhs. And now, going back to our illustration, now let's swap. So, Bhushan's property has been acquired. They are neighbors. So, he can, suppose government pays him 20 lakhs. If circle rate of this area is 40 lakhs, government will pay him 40 lakhs, land acquisition collector will pay you 40 lakhs and nothing more. These are official rates listed in his office. He used these rates and pay you compensation at this basis. You genuinely feel undercompensated because you are neighbors, your property is roughly comparable. So, he goes to court and he tells judge that I have been undercompensated. And his line of reasoning would be, he will use his sale deed to convince a judge that look, this sale deed has listed price of 80 lakhs. Give me 80 lakhs. Compensate me at the rate of 80 lakhs per acre. He would also be tempted to argue that my land is even better than his land, so give me more. But tangible proof he has is of 80 lakhs. What is the truth about 80 lakhs? Remember, 80 lakhs is greater than 40 lakhs, government provided compensation, but it's still less than real market value, which is 1 crore. So, the real dynamics are, government officials, LSE, determine compensation on the basis of circle rates, stamp duty rates, which are generally well below real market rates. Courts use sale deed rates as evidence to estimate market value. Sale deed rates are generally greater than circle rates, but are below market value. Now you can see that this diagram makes sense. Even though courts increase it above government provided compensation, but even judges also restricted forced to remain below true market rates on an average. So, this is the argument to justify, to complete the picture that is depicted here. Yes. The way diagram is depicted, this is absolute value. You can look at it as absolute value. Yes. Bhushan. Eighty white and 20 black.
Yes.
So next time you hear that, you know what is black and white in property transaction. If it is 80 white and 20 black, it means that 1 crore's property will be reported as 80 lakhs property. In some cases, it is much more. But the bottom line remains that almost 90%, 95% of transactions have black and white component. And black component makes gap mismatch between black. If there was no black component, then green line will coincide with black line. There will be truthful reporting, courts will be able to use that and award compensation equal to market value. Because of this black money component, so black money is good in normal times, but it hurts same set of people when your land gets taken away. So this is paradox, Indian paradox of reality sector. In normal times, we don't want to pay tax, we want to lie. And it's good in normal times, but if our property gets taken over by government, then same cheating by us as well as by our neighbors, it affects us, it hurts us.
So my question was, why do you post on just
for the problem will be twofold. No organ of state will admit that there is a black money. So they will say, but that would be. So how can a judge say that, you know, this is a black transaction? You have to admit that evidence as valid evidence. And valid evidence means that you on the face of it, you have to take it as a truthful reporting. Second problem will be that even if judge were to decide, how do you decide whether it was the black-white component was 80-20 or 60-40 or 40-60? So that's the problem. You had a question.
Who is in charge of these survey
rings? Government are, yes, okay. So government, state governments are, or in some cases municipality. If state, generally power vests with the state government. But in some cases for metros, they have vested this power to municipal corporations. But generally the state government, that is direct beneficiary. You will see that state government will have temptation to increase these rates, right? They would want to. But the political economy does not allow them. A government that increases these rates will become more unpopular government. So state governments generally, politicians generally, avoid increasing these rates. Second, even if you increase rates and people are able to lie more, that does not guarantee that increased rate will lead to more revenue collection. You know, suppose work it out.
Yes.
But point is that politicians, governments run by politicians, do not want to increase these rates. They want to keep these rates low. So much these valuations low. As a result, market value is always greater than circle rates, registry rates. And that's why the red line is well below black line.
So when the circle rates become equal to the market value?
They can be made. You know, so Delhi, for example, is most advanced in this case. Kejriwal government increased circle rates, and people have been, traders have been, you know, criticizing Kejriwal. So this was one of the sensible things he did. So far, Delhi government, so tell me one thing. If property is appreciating every year, how frequently you should revise your circle rates? Every year. But Delhi has, in last 20 years, Delhi has made revisions only 3.5 times. 3 times full over 20 years. Kejriwal attempted increased circle rates. Traders are voters of Kejriwal. But now, what is the meaning of increased circle rates? That whenever you and I transact, we will have to pay more tax. More tax make politicians unpopular. So, he has been criticized left and right, and he has reduced back those circle rates. So, the politics of circle rates keep them below market rates. So, we want to cheat. We are a nation of cheaters. You know. So, that's that.
Well.
Yes, that's right. Yes, you have a question. Yes, right. You can always do that. It is as a matter of right. You can always demand more. But whether you will be able to get more or not, that depends on whether you have evidence to support your claim or not. And as I discussed, what constitutes evidence? Sale deeds. If you know that in your neighborhood there was a property that was sold at a price greater than what government has given you, you can use that sale deed as an evidence and demand more from court. In tribal areas where dams are built, problem is that it's hard to find any transaction, any sale deed in same village, in neighboring village also. So generally the problem with farmers in remote villages and tribal areas is, though judicial recourse is available to them as a matter of right, but it is not helpful because they have no evidence to draw upon. And in the absence of evidence, no judge can grant them higher compensation. It is because of that the agriculture land increase in compensation by court for agriculture land was minimal. Because it's hard for them, it's difficult for them to get evidence. That is the... So that's why in tribal areas, this logic, they are not able to benefit from the process. Judicial recourse is not... yes. What's your name?
Neha.
So Neha had argued that if you are poor, how much price will you quote for your own land? It depends, you know, whether you have to quote price as a buyer or as a seller. As a seller, you have a tiny piece of land and you can ask several crores. But if you are asked that you should be able to match, you should have that much purchasing power, right? That much wealth.
Right, but you can say that 75% of
something of that sort is being done under new law. Under new law, so that's what it does for private purpose acquisition. If 80% of owners agree, if I, as a developer, I am able to get consent of 80% of owners, then I don't have to negotiate with the remaining 20. I can pay them price, so that is average or the higher of the price negotiated with the... By even for government funded projects. So some countries actually do that. It's fair, it's better, but it means more work for government. It also means that government's fiscal burden will increase. Right? So if you have to negotiate a price, you will have to pay people more today. That will increase compensation cost. So that will eat into budgetary constraints of state government and the central government. But you can do things that I will argue shortly. Can I, Neha?
So how does the price is determined when an industry? How a price is determined when an industry is set up and the industry acquires the land for
they buy voluntarily. Market price issue remains. So the new Act, 2013 Act, it provides for compensation to owners, property owners, and wherever for urban development projects, it tells that you need to create stakes in the project, which is to say that you take land, but you return some land, 10%, 20% back to the owner after developing it. For other people who were dependent on land but were not owners, you explore ways of giving them jobs in the project. But the issue of compensation still remains. If 20% of your land is returned, you will still be entitled to compensation for 80% of your land on this basis. So this issue will remain valid for whatever land that does not get returned, that gets taken away. The issue of jobs, giving you job in the project, and resettlement and rehabilitation, they are over and above the compensation. Good thing is that resettlement and rehabilitation under the new act is over and above compensation, but compensation is only for property owners who have legal right to, yes. Sorry, which packages?
Rehabilitation,
yes. Yes, but as I said, compensation is for the owners, and resettlement and rehabilitation is for other dependent owner. So these are provisions made under the 2013 Act. Will they lose their occupation, their livelihood, by totally or partially? Will they have to vacate? Will they have to be physically removed from their residences or not? All this documentation is done through social impact assessment. If you do not have provision for social impact assessment, you have no way of knowing who will get affected, how much, who should be given job, who should be rehabilitated and resettled. Does it make sense? So what the government did smartly, it did not remove resettlement and rehabilitation. It kept that provision, but it removed social impact assessment clause. But without doing social impact assessment, you do not know who should be resettled and rehabilitated. So indirectly and smartly, the ordinance had rendered the process of R&R, resettlement and rehabilitation, ineffectual. But there has been a lot of noise against those ordinances, and they have now, they belong to where they should. Yes.
So, having said this, social
that is also, so part of it gets covered by social impact assessment. It is a documentation of the cost, all costs that project will impose on the society, and also the benefits like jobs and so it's an asset, it's a kind of cost benefit analysis, and ideally it is expected to factor in the cost to the environment, and over and above that, the whatever regulations are in place for by the Ministry of Environment, they are also to be complied with. The next topic is litigation, causes and consequences. And here I do not guarantee that I will be able to persuade our lawyer friends, but I guarantee that I will have some new insights for you, something new for you. It will be incomplete picture, but new dimension, interesting picture. So why litigation happens? So applying economic logic, the one reason why litigation happens is that people who are, so suppose you and I have to negotiate over something, it could be that I have caused an accident, I need to compensate you. So in some form I have, for whatever reasons, I have harmed you, and your law gives you, there is a legal entitlement that makes me liable to compensate you. We can avoid litigation if I can offer you compensation that is acceptable to you. If we can do that, there will be no litigation between two of us. Similarly, if government can offer compensation that is acceptable to property owners, there will be no litigation, the type of litigation we talked at length in the previous session. Then question is, why litigation happens? Let's go back to the question, how much you will demand. Suppose I have hurt you in an accident, I owe you compensation, how much will you demand? Your demand, you could argue that you will demand full compensation. That would be one way of looking at this. My answer would be that full compensation, again, is not something that will guide your behavior. You will ask the question, what is that you can get from a court? Because if we disagree, and if we are law-abiding citizens, rather than, you know, working it out through fight, we will go to court. Then whether you will accept my offer or not, it depends on what is the alternative available to you. The civil alternative is to go to court and demand, sue me for damages. If you believe that court will give judgment of J, then you will ask J from me. Right? That's first the first response. But then we also have to worry about litigation cost. Suppose you are, the court is going to award you compensation of 10,000, but in the process you will have to incur 3,000 as litigation expenses, then your net gains will be 7,000. So you should be able to accept my offer if I offer you 7,000, nothing more. Right? That's one way of looking at things. So here in this illustration, but you could argue back, you could say, rather than nodding your head in agreement, you could say that, look, the same litigation will give me net gains of 7,000, but will cost you, what will be cost to me? I will have to pay you 10,000, I will also have to incur, suppose, litigation expenses of 3,000. For me, the same suit will cost 13,000. Rather than nodding in agreement, you are being too naive and nice, you could say, wait a minute, if we go to court, you will have to incur expenditure of 13,000, give me 13,000, right? So there we could head for problem, you know. So I of course will not give more than 13,000, you will not accept anything less than 7,000. Where do we meet between 7,000 and 16,000. So that depends on whether who is nice, both are equally nice, or one is nastier than the other, or if they are both hard-headed, they may not agree on anything and end up incurring litigation expenses. But in any situation, in this illustration, what are the gains? What are the gains if we avoid litigation? We save 3,000 of your litigation fee and we save 3,000 of my litigation expenses. Net gains between two of us will be 6,000. And that also is difference between 7,000 and 13,000. So essentially the fight will be how to divide these gains for gains we will have by saving litigation expenses. But suppose we are nice and we divide these gains, we say that, okay, so you keep your litigation expenses, I keep mine, that means we agree on 10,000, we divide midway. Does that make sense? For this scheme of things to work, we should believe that merit of your case is identical. We should believe that if you go to court, judge is going to give you 10,000 with certainty. If I suspect merit of your case, suppose rule of negligence is, judge is going to apply rule of negligence, and I believe I am going to be, you will be plaintiff, you will argue negligence on my behalf, I will put defense arguing that there was no negligence, I was driving within speed limit, I had observed all traffic signals, there was no negligence on my part, there was contributory negligence on his part. Suppose I genuinely believe that you do not have a strong case and you believe you have a strong case, then you will think that you are bound to get at least 7,000, 10,000 minus litigation expenses. And if I believe that you have a very weak case, then I might believe that the chances that you will win are very low. Chances that I will be made liable to compensate you are very low. Then I will not offer you, my litigation expenses will not be 13,000, total cost will not be 10,000 plus 3,000, it will be 3,000 plus, suppose I believe that you have even chances of winning, which is to say that probability is half, then my cost, I am looking at cost litigation expenses of 3,000 plus 5,000 as a liability, as expected liability. So I will offer you no more than 8,000. Right? So, different belief about judicial outcome is one reason why people will end up litigating. Even though they want to settle, but if there are different beliefs, then we will experience litigation in equilibrium. Does it make sense? And so this is one of the reasons for litigation is differences in beliefs about judicial outcome. So I am going to sum this discussion up. I have talked about all these. You were very nice to nod in whatever I said. Now, question is, why beliefs about judicial outcome can differ between the potential litigants? We have agreed, you were nice to agree, that if there are different beliefs about judicial outcome, then settlement becomes less likely. Then let's ask the question, why people might have different belief about judicial outcome? I want you to make some right, yes. Okay, before we come to asymmetric information, so there are psychologists study individual behaviors, economists also study individual behaviors through experiments, through lab experiments. Generally, people suffer from optimum bias. Since you know your side of story, that's true in any relationship, in any discussion, in any dispute, be it legal, be it domestic. Since you know your perspective, you do not know, even if your other side is talking to you repeatedly, we still lose some part, some information from the other side. So as a result, people always believe, generally believe, that their case is stronger than what it actually is. So both sides suffer from optimum bias. It means that you believe that you will be able to prove negligence on my part, even though you do not have a strong case. I will believe that I will be able to prove contributory negligence on your part and will be able to put up a good defense, even though you have a strong case. So, I believe that court outcome is going to be more in my favor, you believe it's going to be in your favor. So, this is how human beings are made, that's what behavioral sciences tell us. That's one reason, and that's generally the case with any family related disputes. So, it's hard to get other side's story. So, both sides suffer from optimum bias. So, think about it in different situations. Then we also know that different individuals have different abilities to sustain litigation process. If you are you think of suing a big corporation versus a poor chap. So, big corporation can, the wealthy, deep pocket individuals or companies can drag the litigation and make your life miserable. They have numerous ways of making life difficult for the other side. So, if parties are differently abled to during litigation process, one has greater ability resources than the other, then that will also show up in judicial outcome. The weaker side will not be able to sustain litigation process. All right? Does that make sense? That has two implications. On one hand, the stronger side will make ridiculously low offer. So, if I know that I am much richer than you, I will make you low offer, you will find that outrageous, will reject the offer and we may end up before court. In extreme case, if I am super rich and you are super poor, in that case, you may decide not to go after me at all. So, this asymmetric power, to an extent, it can increase litigation, it can also reduce litigation, because if the plaintiff has no hope of carrying it through against a powerful opponent, then they will not start, they will not bring the suit in the first place. So, it cuts both ways. Then there is informational asymmetry. Another source of litigation is why we will fail to negotiate. Asymmetric power, one is richer than the other, we will fail to reach an agreement. I will make ridiculously low offer, you will feel outraged and reject. So, no settlement, we may end up litigating. Third reason is what I have listed as first reason, asymmetric information about judicial outcome. I may know something more about a judge or judicial process than you do. That would mean that even if your case is strong, I know that essentially it will boil down to a weak case. But you do not know what I know. You are guided by merit of your case, you believe it's a strong case. So you, and I am guided by that ultimately judge is going to rule my way. Therefore, I will make low offer, you will again reject it and we will end up before court. So these are some of the reasons. Can we explain corruption here? Corruption can also be explained either in terms of the rich having more ability to sustain the litigation process, or if your judges are corruptible. I am not saying judges are. Suppose judges are corruptible, in that case that would also be like asymmetric information. If a judge is corruptible and I have a contact, then I know that essentially your case will die, but you don't know that, and therefore we will fail to reach a settlement and will end up litigating neha.
So can political biasness, I mean the local party supporting you, can be a what happened in
So that, like, that's like last reason, different abilities to sustain litigation. If you get either financial resources or political support, your ability to sustain a litigation process, it goes up.
Sir, here you have listed informational asymmetry about the judicial outcome, but I believe that there is informational asymmetry about my care also, which I don't think would come under optimal balance, because I will know more how much care I took than the other party would.
So, this is interesting point. So, thinking of an accident, there are two dimensions. One is how much care I as a injurer, as a driver exercised, how much care you as a pedestrian, as a victim of this accident exercised. We will have to prove this before court. It doesn't help that I know full picture about myself. It doesn't help that you know you have full picture about yourself. We will have to prove it to third party, right? However, there is other dimension. You may have peculiar condition. Suppose you suffered from some medical condition that I didn't know, but you know that. So suppose you had some special, you were differently abled or disabled. I don't know that, you knew that, and your compensation, you will demand compensation on that count also. But again, that also means that there is informational asymmetry about judicial outcome. You know that judge will have to compensate me not only for direct damages, but also additional damages I have suffered because of my medical condition, my special condition. That will also reduce the probability chances of successful pre-trial negotiation, will lead to litigation. Question about it? So a pessimist plaintiff is the one who feels that I don't stand good chances against this man. Yeah, mediation. So the role of mediation process is, actually you should ask as many questions as you can. We have seen, here are policy implications. We have seen that if there is asymmetry, let's go back to this. Either there is asymmetry about judicial outcome, or optimum bias, or different abilities to sustain litigation. They are bad for settlement, right? They reduce chances of successful pre-trial settlements. The role of arbitration is to reduce informational asymmetry. A good arbitrator will tell that, you know, party who is feeling unreasonably optimistic, separately, not in presence of defendant, will tell plaintiff that don't be super optimistic. You know, there's a defense that will come. The other side will be arguing and you will be answering these questions also. A good arbitrator will also tell the defendant that don't be highly confident. I think you have a weak case. The other party has a strong case. Idea is that if you reduce if you bring their beliefs together, by that process, you increase chances of successful settlement. So a good arbitrator should try to reduce informational asymmetry about judicial outcome, about optimum bias, and also their abilities to sustain the case. So these are, and that way, you know, so you save court's time, but you also save litigation expenses of these guys. Thank you for stopping me there. So, but otherwise, if your plaintiff is, your victim is pessimist, then that reduces chances of successful pre-trial negotiations. Because a pessimist will ask for less. And your opposite will hold you if your plaintiff is too optimistic. So, a too optimistic plaintiff will believe that court is going to rule his or her way and will agree to nothing less than 13,000. And that will reduce chances of pre-trial successful negotiation. So in many situations, so there are, you know, so I often use this example. So what if you board a flight, what is the probability that plane will crash? Is it zero? Is it zero? No. If you know that this flight will crash, will you board that? No. We believe it never occurs to us that we are in next few hours, couple of hours, next 10 hours, we might not be around with positive probability. We don't think about it every single time we vote, and you should not. I am citing this as an evidence that we all suffer from optimum bias. Every single time we board a flight, we are looking at it as if it's a zero probability, zero event. So every single time a patient gets operated upon a surgeon, surgeons fail, you know, operations are unsuccessful. But if, suppose, you know, a surgeon's failure rate is 10% and a surgeon has operated already that day 9 patients, all successful. If someone took this probability too literally, the 10th patient will think that it's my turn and will not volunteer. Of course, you know that this is not how probabilities work, but all of us suffer from optimum bias. And there is a role for arbitration, for mediation to reduce this optimum bias. But in other situations, we should continue to have optimum bias, like boarding a flight or, for that matter, train. Or then let's now look at other reasons behind why litigation happens. So far, our discussion was mainly in terms of monetary demand and monetary liability. Not all disputes litigation is about monetary damages, economic losses. At times, people feel cheated, emotionally hurt, and they are not so much after monetary compensation, but to fix the guy or the woman, whoever the other side is. So in such cases, they don't want to talk about settlement unless you have, you know, undergone the grinding of judicial process for several years. You are not ready for any talk, any negotiations. That is the case in many, you know, where relationships are involved, even between brothers, you know, over dispute of ancestral property, parents at times. So, but spousal disputes are, you know, most difficult, least amenable to any kind of mediation, especially in the beginning, because it's not, essentially they say everything is about money, but not, at least not in the beginning, it's about something else, and there are other considerations. Then yet other times strategic behavior also incentivizes people to bring frivolous lawsuits. Imagine a scenario, the other region, and I'm talking about second bullet. Even if disputants are guided by monetary considerations, private negotiations may not succeed because of asymmetric information that we have covered already. But strategic, too demanding behavior. In our first example, your net gain will be 7,000, my cost will be 13,000. So where do we agree? If both of us are very difficult person, you will demand 13,000 from me, I will try to pin you down to 7,000, and we may fail to meet midway. In some other situations, if there are judicial delays, then I may be inclined to bring a frivolous suit against you and force you to pay me something, even though you have not essentially harmed me. That is part of the picture when it comes to litigation in India. Then there are incentives for lawyers. So our lawyers are so charitable. So there's a, you know, you can pay your lawyers either for every appearance, or you can sell your case to them. For example, if you meet with an accident, you can tell your lawyer, so in US, your lawyers, there are law firms that will come to you, they will say that, you know, so we will go after the injurer, but I give you this compensation, and you let me take over this case. Yes. So they work on contingent fee basis. So, which is illegal in India because it's so charitable profession. Well, as the case may be, when you both systems have their problems, But in India, in many situations, lawyers do not stand to lose if matters get dragged, you know, as long as they are getting paid for every appearance they are, for every work they are having to do. Is that fair to say? That lawyers never emerge victim of judicial delay. So it's like for you, it's like for landowners in land acquisition compensation. The flip side is always zero, you don't lose. Either you win, and in that time you may be in slight hurry, but the opposing counsel wants to delay the matters that. And for you, what is the flip side? You don't win, you don't lose. So for you, if you are strong party, you are representing a strong case, there is no flip side. If you are representing a weak, if you have a weak case, then you have incentives to drag the matter and harass the other party to make sense in your ridiculously offensive offer. So the incentives for lawyers also is a problem. Now in US, in developed countries, law firms want to borrow so that they can litigate more vigorously. But it's illegal to lend to law firms so that they can carry on their practice better. Did I make myself clear? In US and UK, law firms, there are registered law firms, they want to borrow from banks as working capital so that, you know, they can hire smarter lawyers, they can mount more offensive attack on the opposite side. But it's illegal for banks to lend to law firms as for working capital so that they can litigate more aggressively. Because they are not, you know, these are not charitable donations. You are going after the other side. So they don't, the state, society doesn't want to promote such activities. But, you know, capitalism has its own ways. It's illegal to lend money to lawyers and law firms, but not to litigants. So banks have started to identify potential litigants. So if you file for a divorce and you will hear a phone call, you will get a phone call from one of the bankers. Or do you need loan, you know, to go after your spouse? You will need money. So it's like something like this, equipping, you know, you don't have a gun, we will give you a gun to go after each other. So such type of incentives also increase chances of, I'm not making it up, there was an article in The Economist, and this picture is from there actually. So it's like, you know, giving guns to warring parties who, and you know what happens in that case. Then there are incentives for judges. Do judges also gain from judicial delays? Let me ask my lawyer friends. They do not. But do judges do things that increase delays? Sorry? In my opinion, judges do two things that increase delays. Adjournment is, so by the way, you know, the adjournment is that, you know, Sunny Deol's famous dialogue, mili nyaya nahi mila, mili to sirf tarikh. That's adjournment. And judges, for one reason or the other, they of course are overworked and over, you know, it's also, to be fair to them, there's too much pressure on them. As a result, they have to give adjournment. So, Civil Procedure Code was amended in 1992 and then in 1994 and then 2002. So, the idea was to curb this practice by judges so that they don't give more than 3 adjournment in a case. But then Supreme Court undermined that provision by saying that it's no, you don't have to go for literal reading of it. So there are genuine circumstances on which under in which you can give. It's not like, you know, strictly binding on judges. It's more of a advice rather than a rule. However, notice judges can do several things. They can give 20 adjournments and still report only 3 adjournments. How? In their order sheet, they do not, you know, who says order sheet? You know, generally, you know, you can always find fault either from the plaintiff side's counsel, you know, Your Honor, so are you ready with this? I will bring next time, Your Honor, or defendant side. And that's what he notes. Oh, okay, so the main counsel is not available for plaintiff side or defendant side, or, you know, he is represented by proxy, or this party has a short time to produce this document. Essentially, they are adjourning a case, but they do not report it as an adjournment. They report as a time sought by one of the parties involved. So this is one way they do scuttle this, undermine, game with the system. But this is like anyone will do. There are 2 things that judges can do but don't do, and that aggravates the problem of judicial delays. One is, especially in civil matters, we know that many cases are frivolous cases. They are there for strategic reasons or whatever. If a judge spends 5 minutes asking question to person, addressing some questions to the person that has brought a suit, a complaint, judge will be able to see that it's a frivolous case and can throw it where it should go, to dustbin. They do not spend 1 minute in examining merit of the case when the case is brought, a suit is brought before them. It is procedural practice is, they will list the matter so that other side respondent has to respond in writing, and then, you know, by the time responses are in and they can say anything, some other judge is around, so this judge has been transferred. So 5 minutes spent, maybe I'm exaggerating, 10-15 minutes spent in the beginning can save surely 15 days to 30 days of court's time and also parties' time.
So, there is one more reason. That is the lower judiciary, the judges are not so skillful.
They are skillful in not reporting an adjournment as adjournment, in not asking question. And why don't they examine? Because they know that by the time it will be time to adjudicate on this dispute, I will not be around. It will take several years and I will be gone. So somebody else, my colleague, will adjudicate. So I save my 1 minute's comfort, 5 minutes comfort, to put hell on my colleague, and my colleague does same thing to me. So it's, you know, public bad that gets created in the process.
Not always true. So, I mean, one way the system is like that. India is an adversarial jurisdiction, which means that the plaintiff and the defendant lawyers will argue amongst each other to bring out the facts, and also we are the ones who will oppose each other.
there is something to this argument, but I will disagree with you, Bhushan. You know, if a judge says that, you know, there is nothing in this case and dismissed, then maybe the party will go to high court and maybe this judge may get berated by a high court judge. But if a judge says that, you know, on this ground I am saying there is nothing, I have looked at the petition doesn't seem to be tenable on this count, on this count, on this count. How much time will this take? One hearing and 10-15 minutes of judge in dictating. A judge should be seen as having applied his or her mind. That judge cannot be faulted with. No high court judge can berate. You know, of course, you dismiss it outrightly without giving any reason. I am saying that in many cases, you know, it turns out after 6 years that the suit was brought under a section under which it was not admissible at all. But that happens, and I am sure you know this, that in many cases judges give this ruling after 10 years, after 6 years, after 16 years. Why did you harass the other side for so many years? When you know all you needed is, what is the nature of claim, is it admissible under this section or not? As simple as this. All right, so let's go on. You have a question? No, Neha, you have. Let's ask our lawyer friends about this. No, one should speak, one person at a time, so that we all benefit from the discussion. Incidentally, yesterday, it was day before yesterday, we were Dr. Prasad, Professor Schaefer. So we had dinner together and we were talking about judicial delays. So, and also, you know, lawsuits against celebrities. So at times they get dragged, even in US they get dragged for several years. In our country, only God knows for how long they can last. So Professor Schaefer said that, I asked him that how much time courts take to adjudicate these cases, you know, which invariably get dismissed ultimately. But the press, media and people have fun for some time. So I asked him, how long does it take in Germany for such cases? So he said that not long, but one case took quite long. So I asked him, how long did this quite long took? So he said 6 months. He said one case took quite long, it took 6 months. And here in India, if you get a chance to file a reply in 6 months, you know, in 6 years, if you can guarantee, there is no guarantee that both sides will be able to present their case before judges. These claims, common law versus civil law, they are exaggerated. Here, we follow common law tradition, it's adversarial with passive, neutral, empire judges. That's the depiction, that's the picture that is painted of Indian judicial system. But it's incorrect to say that Indian judges do not ask questions. Depending on judge, they do ask questions. Depending on judges, they do tell that, you know, yes, you are here, but you should think twice before, you know, deciding whether you want to go ahead with this case or not. There are. It's just that unfortunately proportion of those judges, and it's not illegal for them to ask questions. It's not illegal. They are. So if you issue a summon, then you as a judge, if you judge, you issue a summon, then you have admitted preponderance of something there, right? So you have participated, and at that stage, some judges do take, do ask questions, few but meaningful questions. It's more of inertia on their part. Similarly, in civil law judicial system, it's incorrect to say that only judges make queries. So both system, ours is primarily adversarial and civil law is primarily inquisitorial system. But both systems have feature of the other and allow judges to do whatever they want to do, and they are able to do. No, so we might not be, it's no, the other, perhaps the right way is not to argue that ours is not jury-based adjudication, therefore there are delays. Perhaps there are delays are so long that you can't afford jury trials. But the reason we do not have jury trial, I think jury trials were killed by a famous person, cricketer, was that person, some celebrity in Mumbai, Navy admiral who did something. Well, but you want to add something? I forgot to, so in these cases, in these examples, there are two parties who are at war with each other. At least one party has incentive, the party with weak case has incentive to drag the matters. Even in, so let me tell something to my lawyer friends, here is something for you. Even in eminent domain cases, where there is no incentive, so in eminent domain cases, I told you, remember I told you that one case was 41 years old. In eminent domain cases also, there are two parties, the property owners is plaintiff, defendant is government. Government lawyers, and government lawyers, let me take your attention, read this judgment. This is a quote from judgment of Punjab and Haryana High Court. And lawyers will understand, for non-lawyers, let me tell you that here the court is High Court, Punjab and Haryana High Court. HUDA, HUDA is Haryana Urban Development Authority. So, state of Haryana and HUDA are represented by a government lawyer before High Court. So, and government lawyers, with due respect to them, they do not care great deal about judicial outcome. Unlike in private civil dispute where two lawyers care about judicial outcome, when it comes to government, when government is defendant, nobody cares. This is direct quote from judgment. So, court is saying, let me straight away take your attention. what is generally seen is that practically no evidence is led by Huda. Huda means Huda's lawyer, government lawyer, in any of the cases before reference court. Reference court is lower court. And similar is the position with regard to addressing arguments before the higher court. So they are saying that essentially it's government, it's a property owner's lawyer who does all the talking and producing evidence. It's one-sided affair, right? It's your civil law adjudication at work. Neutral judges, neutral passive government lawyers, only one side. It's open, the field is open to government lawyers. Here is another excerpt from another judgment of High Court. So let me read it out. What has been experienced in number of cases which came before this court? This court is High Court. In none of the cases where Huda was represented by a counsel, government counsel, anything was done by him, the government counsel, except getting his presence marked. The position is not different even in proceedings before the court below. It's not, I am not making up, I have provided complete reference, you can verify it. Even when there is no incentive for other side to drag the matter. Matters, one case was 41 year old. So this speaks volume about state of affairs. So what judges can do, what they actually are doing. All right, does it, that's fair, right? So it's not that only adversarial system. Of course, this is also, in latter it's adversarial, but in essence it's open to. And this also shows that if you are high value property owner, you are a resourceful person, what you do, you hire smart lawyers. Government lawyers are not going to do anything. Field will be open to creativity of you and your lawyer. And if you are a poor farmer in a remote village, first of all, you cannot afford litigation. Even if you had some money, you do not know how to find, where to find smart lawyers and where to make them creative. So, however, in government, so I must say that at one place, there is incentive to drag the matter. There is one incentive, the lawyer do not have incentive when it comes to eminent domain cases. Government lawyers do not have incentives to drag the matter. They are being nice and, you know, so it's over to the other side. But government of the day has incentive to drag the matter. Why do they have incentive to drag the matter? Why governments pay compensation which is ridiculously low? Their justification is that stamp duty rates, circle rates we discussed. But it's more than that. Suppose I am a politician, I am a chief minister of a state. If I want to lay foundation stones for several projects, schools, hospitals, roads, railways, I need land for that. If I make generous payment that will be acceptable by, will be acceptable to property owner, that will cut into my budget today. Does it make sense? However, if I make ridiculously low offer, I know property owners will feel agitated, they will go to court, court is going to take decades, and by the time court gives its ruling and it's time to make actual payment, I will not be chief minister anymore. Somebody else will bear the consequence. So government of the day has incentive, strategic incentive, to make ridiculously low offer so that litigation happens, so that they have more money to do other things. They can launch more project with same money. That happens with our judges also. Our judges do not exercise due diligence, do not pay attention when a suit is brought, because they know that by the time that cost is to be incurred, it will be somebody else who will have to incur the cost of reading the petition and responses and all. So this, if there are delays, they compound each other, they snowball. It becomes incentive compatible. If there are delays, it becomes incentive compatible to force people to go to court asking for compensation. As more people are forced to go to court, judicial delays become worse, the situation becomes worse. As situation becomes worse, it gets better for politicians. So here, these are also some of the political economy reasons that that cause judicial delays. Lastly, I want to discuss a legal doctrine, and it could be something new for my lawyer friends also. So, this is also, so at time, laws legislated with a good intent may end up having perverse, negative, just opposite effect. I don't know if you have heard of prohibition of reformatio in PS. It is a legal doctrine mainly used in civil law countries. European Court of Justice uses this doctrine in intellectual patent related disputes. What does this doctrine say? This doctrine says, maybe if you can ignore, don't look at slides. So, let me explain the situation. Suppose a government of the day has made some ruling, has awarded compensation. So, municipality was not keeping, doing good job of maintaining roads, there were potholes, somebody fell in that, in manhole and got hurt or died. Municipality or government makes some award, compensation award. This doctrine says that recipient of that award should be able to appeal against that administrative order without any fear. So, it's right to be able to appeal without fear. How can you appeal without fear? You can appeal against an administrative award without fear if you know that appellate authority, court, will not make your situation worse than it is today. Does that make sense? We saw in land acquisition cases, this principle was at work. Property owners knew that the bottom line, the worst case scenario is what they have already got, right? So, indirectly, it was this principle that was at work. The bottom line was, you will end up getting what administrative award is, and you may get more. Only then you can appeal without fear. Isn't it fair? So, this doctrine is explicitly used in civil law countries when it comes to appeal against administrative award, government awards. Indian lawmakers, parliament also wanted to act. So, it's essentially supposed to be protection to people who are recipient beneficiary of these awards. That's the idea. Indian parliament in its wisdom also thought that we should protect farmers, and they introduced an amendment to 1894 by inserting a section, by amending section 25, that explicitly told courts that court award cannot be less than government award. That is why in my data set, the minimum increase was zero. It was not choice available to judge to reduce. Judges had only two choices, either to dismiss the case with same compensation or increase. So, here Indian parliament explicitly inserted this prohibition of reformatio in PS. All right. On the face of it, it was pro-farmer legislation to protect interest of farmer. What is the outcome? As a result of this seemingly pro-farmer, a welfare amendment, it led to two perverse outcomes. One, it made litigation risk-free lottery for property owners. So, almost everybody has incentive to go and ask for more. Two, politicians have exploited the judicial delays to make low offer. So, as a result, every property owner is forced to go to court to demand to get their due. So, a legislation that on face of it, in its intent was to protect interest of farmer, actually has ended up harming their interest. So, this is a perverse outcome of seemingly pro-poor, pro-farmer, pro-public legislative interventions. So, it is not straightforward for lawyers, judges and policy makers to see through these implications. It is there that economic analysis of law can play direct meaningful role in telling that this will be implication of this legislative intervention. So, again a pro-farmer law, how it can end up harming the property owners, farmers. This is slide. The question is, new law is better than old law. I said that it is better partly because it has increased compensation from 1.3 times to 2 times to 4 times. What will happen to litigation? If you pay more to farmers, property owners, will that reduce litigation? Not necessarily. If you are government officials, land acquisition collectors and judges keep on doing what they do, it can actually strengthen, intensify litigation. Why it can do that? So, today imagine a property that is 100 square meters. Suppose circle rate, stamp duty rate in that area is 1000 per square meter, but there is a sale deed available at the rate of 1300. So, today government officials use 1000 as a basis for compensation, judges will use sale deed rates 1300. If litigation happens, the property owner will be able to increase compensation, how much? 39,000, because his compensation will increase 1.3 times, including solatium. New law doubles this 1.3 times to up to 4 times. Same property and same thing if happens under new law, the gain from litigation will be 1,20,000. Suppose litigation expenses are 50,000. Today litigation will not happen because gains are less than the litigation cost. But under new law, even where there would be no profitable litigation, litigation can become profitable. So, unless we change how initial compensation is awarded and reduce scope for profitable litigation, the new increased multiplier, rather than benefiting property owners, can actually end up harming them by perpetuating the dynamics of initial law offer, litigation, litigation expenses, judicial delays. I'm done.